all get yourself settled and take your seats. We've got a lot to cover today, so let me just take a moment and welcome all of you, and then also give you a little lay of the land. Obviously, I'm going to introduce my panelists, but I'm sure you know who they are, but I'll still do that as a formality. And then also let you know that we're going to break up our discussion in segments, and we will be having a Q&A at the end of each segment, as well as at the end of the program. So over the next hour and a half, we're going to talk about what makes a quality audit, exploring the perspectives of audit committees, particularly around audit quality indicators. So I know the sign outside said one thing, and your discussion said another, but really what we want to talk about are audit quality indicators and what those might look like and why both the PCAOB and the CAQ has an effort underway, as well as getting audit committee perspectives. So let me just briefly introduce you to our panelists. On my far right, I have Leslie Seidman. We have Leslie Seidman, whom I think most of you know. She, of course, is the immediate past chair of FASB, where she served as a board member from 2003 until 2013. She's now the executive director of the Center for Excellence in Financial Reporting at the Lubin School of Business at Pace University. And she also serves on two audit committees, both Moody's and FINRA. So she, perhaps most importantly for this panel, also we had her serve as the moderator of two roundtable discussions we had with audit committees, one in New York and one in Chicago, talking about audit quality indicators and the expectations of audit committees. So she can speak both as an audit committee member and then also being the moderator of those two discussions. Up next to Leslie is Stephen Shipman. Stephen is the Senior Vice Chair of Grant Thornton LLP, and up until this past January was the firm's CEO. Stephen also served on the CAQ's governing board, and for this topic, we were very pleased at the CAQ to have Stephen be the lead, the champion for the governing board on our AQI project. And then last but not least, immediately next to me is Lou Ferguson, whom I'm sure you all know. I will just remind you that he is a member of the PCAOB and has been since January 2011, and was recently reappointed for a second term ending in October of 2019. So congratulations on that, Lou. And Lou's been very active and continues to be active on IFIAR, the Forum of Independent Audit Regulators. So that is the audit regulators, the global audit regulators come together in this group called IFIAR. And Lou was the immediate past chair of that group and is now very active in the working group on global public policy issues. So we have provided to you on your chairs both the PCAOB's fact sheet on their audit quality indicators project, as well as the CAQ's, a fact sheet on the CAQ's approach. So let me just tell you what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the PCAOB's concept release, which is actually out for comment right now. And I will encourage all of you as academics and practitioners to please read the concept release and respond, as I'm sure Lou will encourage you to do as well. So we're going to talk about the PCAOB's concept release. We're going to talk about the CAQ's approach to audit quality indicators. Leslie then will give us some audit committee perspectives, and then we'll do a little tour around the world and look at what's going on globally. So those are the four segments. We'll stop after each segment, take your questions, as well as have questions at the end. So with that, let me turn, Lou, to you. As the fact sheet says, the PCAOB has a concept release out asking people's perspectives on 28 audit quality indicators. But before we dive into that, I wanted you to, well, I guess first of all, there's something you have to share with us. But then after that, I would want to ask you, before we get into the 28, I want to ask you why now. So this please share with us, and then.
This is not a secret that I'm going to share with you. This is the fact that I'm not allowed to open my mouth without saying that whatever I say here are my own views and are not the views necessarily of the Public Company Accounting Oversight Board or of its members or of its staff. So that's the secret.
There you go. So do tell us, though, your concept release that you recently issued at the PCAOB, why did you choose to do that now?
Well, we did it. You have to go back. There's a little bit of history here. You have to go back to 2008 and the ACAP recommendations, where one of the recommendations was that we should look at, or someone should look at, basically whether there can be audit quality indicators identified, things that are objectively measurable measures of audit quality, if they would be effective, and if so, should they be mandated for public disclosure. That was essentially what ACAP said. So in 2012, we began to look at this process. We started an initiative to do it. Over the last 3 years, we've had a number of roundtables and things like that on that, and we've come up with this concept release. Part of the purpose of it was the view that the audit is really a bit like an iceberg. What the public and even audit committees see of the audit is a very, very limited view. You do not really see what goes on in the audit work. You don't understand what happens beneath the surface. And most of the really interesting work, most of the important work, happens in ways that are not transparent to the public or even to audit committees. Part of the view is that that has certain pernicious effects, one of them being that if you can't understand what's really going on in an audit, you're kind of left with competing on things like price, on things you can see and you can measure. And I think the idea is that that's not a good situation to be in. So to the extent we can come up with objectively measurable measures that can be correlated with audit quality, the profession will be better off.
So now let's talk about the actual AQIs that you have in your concept release. I know Greg Jonas worked very hard under the direction of the board, did a lot of outreach to various groups. Whom do you hope to hear from with respect to your AQI project? And are there other mechanisms other than just responding to the concept release that you're going to elicit feedback?
Well, first of all, we'd like to hear from all of you. So to the extent you look at these things and have views, please submit comment letters. Our comment period is still open. We'll have roundtables after that. So to the extent that you'd like to participate in a roundtable, please let Greg Jonas or other people know that you'd like to come to one of these things. We'll have, this is the beginning of a journey. So this will be a process. There'll be many opportunities, I think, to comment on this. So I would encourage all of you to be active in the process.
So tell us about the AQIs. How did you organize them? How did you come up with them?
Oh, we essentially divide them into three buckets that I would call first people, then process, and by people I mean the audit professionals, the people who are actually doing the work. Process is the process of the audit itself, what actually is going on in the audit. And finally, results. What were the results of the audit? What was measurable in there? Under people, we have three sub-buckets: availability, competence, and focus. And those are measures like staff leverage, partner workload, manager and staff workload, the experience of the audit personnel, industry expertise, audit hours, and the risk areas, things like that. We have a total of 28 measures in total. That's probably too many. Ultimately, and what we don't want to do is overwhelm audit committees and other users. But to start out with, we'd rather cast the net more widely than not widely enough. So when we get comments in on it, on things like audit process, we look at the results of independence, quality ratings, compliance with the firm's internal quality controls results, the PCAOB results. And on the results, we look at things like results in financial statements. Were there problems with financial statements? Were there restatements, for example? Were internal control and going concern matters reported in a timely way? What about enforcement and litigation matters that grew out of these cases? These would be, again, measures of things that might have involved problems in the audit. So those are the kinds of measures. And you can see all these things detailed in our release.
So what do you hope people will do when they see these numbers? numbers, right? Most of these have numbers associated with them, the number of hours or the turnover rate. How does that help a reader, whether it's a regulator, an audit committee member, or a member of the public, to discern audit quality from looking at those numbers?
Well, first of all, let me say that we do not intend these to be any kind of scorecard or report card. They're intended to be measures that will prompt further questions. They are intended to be things that will allow you to have deeper and more meaningful discussions with your auditors or with auditors, for example. Ultimately, to the extent any of these things become public, they may allow comparisons among firms. Or, for example, I could imagine if, for example, a number of these metrics were available and I were on an audit committee, I would certainly want to ask my, and it depends on the level at which they're, you know, another question here is at what level are they reported? Are they reported at an engagement level? Are they reported at a firm level? Are they reported by industry? I mean, these are questions that we're simply asking. We haven't decided, made any decisions on these. But if I had, let's assume they were reported by firm, and I had those measures and I were on an audit committee, I'd want to know, okay, how does my audit compare with your firm-wide statistics? How did the measures in my particular audit compare with your other clients in the same industry? And explain to me if there are deviations. Why were there deviations? What did this mean? It's simply a way, I think, of allowing a more meaningful dialogue between the audit committee and the auditor.
So when you talk about the dialogue, and I'm sure Stephen will get into this when he talks about the CAQ approach, because we too think there needs to be a dialogue. That seems to me that we're talking primarily about a set of indicators that would go to the audit committee to be able to facilitate that discussion. But that is one of the questions that you have, right? Which is, at what level should these indicators apply? That is, should it be network-wide, firm-wide, engagement team-wide, individual, auditor-wide? Should they be mandatory versus voluntary? And to whom do they get disclosed? These
right.
are all open questions
open
as
questions.
I read your concept release. Any leanings one way or the other, or
I don't think so. I mean, I think we are agnostic on that at the present time. I mean, I can imagine they certainly would be useful. There's no question I think they'd be useful to audit committees. Would disclosing of them to the public at some level be useful? Maybe, maybe not. I'm not sure. That's something we want to hear about. What I think we don't want to do, you've always got to be careful when you put rules or regulations in place. You must be very careful about unintended consequences. And I think what we don't want to do is do something that actually creates harm or creates information that is, in fact, misleading. So that's why, you know, we'd like to hear from people at what level they should be disclosed and whether they should be mandatory or not.
Okay, so I'm going to pause here, and I appreciate you might not have questions quite yet until you hear from Stephen and Leslie, but I do want to pause and see if anybody has questions specifically for Lou on the PCAOB's approach. Okay. So, Stephen, I'm going to turn to you now and ask you to walk us through the CAQ's approach. And take us on the journey first of how we got to where we are. In the CAQ, we published our AQI approach in April of this year, so it's been out there for a while.
Yes, thank you, Cindy. Good afternoon, everyone. This really began for the CAQ with a dialogue at the governing board level about an opportunity to look for ways to measure audit quality in a fashion that would help to continue to improve audit quality, to demonstrate where progress was being made in improving audit quality, and perhaps to identify where there was more work to be done. And that was really the broad conversation that started taking place at the governing board. As a result of that, we formed a task force with senior professionals from the firms represented on the governing board, which are, for the most part, the largest auditing firms within the United States, but a pretty diverse group in terms of background, industry, and capability and focus. And we started debating this issue. And one of the things we learned very quickly was that this is a very challenging topic. Not least of which, as one of my colleagues reminded me today, we struggle to even define audit quality. We had several meetings, I think, before we got past the issue of, well, you know, we may need to move forward without having a perfect definition of audit quality in order to make progress on this topic. So we debated a number of different things. Should these measures be at the professional level, at the profession level rather, at the firm level, at the engagement level, or all three? Input measures versus output measures, quantitative measures versus qualitative measures. And there was a very significant and robust debate around all of those topics. In order to help us, we put together an advisory, a stakeholder advisory panel with audit committee members, academics, investors, and other stakeholders in the financial reporting chain. And we used that advisory stakeholder panel as a sounding board, as a group to really help us as we grappled with this conversation. And here's where we landed after quite some considerable effort. We landed on an engagement level focus. We felt that that's where the most value could be created in terms of both measuring and improving audit quality. We landed on the fact that it needed to be a set of indicators rather than any particular indicator, that it would really require looking at a number of indicators together as a whole in order to draw an opinion on audit quality. And the third element that we landed upon in our debate was that the primary point of communication as it related to delivering and discussing the indicators would be audit committees, because of audit committees' significant role in the oversight and completion of a high quality audit function at the registrants. We use some criterion to determine what type of indicators, the qualities of the indicators that we wanted to land upon. So we wanted indicators that could be consistently measured over time, that we could actually capture, that weren't going to be so incredibly difficult to actually get the information that they would not be very useful, that they were objective and scalable. We recognize that registrants are of very significantly different sizes, and audit firms are of different sizes in terms of their scale and capabilities, in terms of resources and the types of clients that they're auditing. We divided our set of indicators into four areas: firm leadership and tone at the top, engagement, the engagement team and the knowledge and the work experience of that engagement team, the monitoring section, which was really looking at the results of internal and external oversight of the audit process, and reporting, audit reporting, which really gets to one of the comments that Lou made about reissuance restatements. Maybe I'll pause there, Cindy. You might want to add, actually, as you were very involved in this process. Did I miss anything, or would you embellish anything?
No, I might give a few, a little bit of color. One thing I would note is that while we have four categories, I think they line up very nicely with what the PCAOBs were. Ours are firm leadership, a tone at the top, and engagement team knowledge, experience, and workload. And so I think the PCAOB combined those into the audit professionals bucket. And then we have monitoring, which I think is corollary to process. And then we have reporting, and you all have results. So I think they're very similar. We've just used different words to describe it. And then another thing that we were hopeful would give us some insights, and they gave us a few insights, but not as, I don't think, as much as we wanted, is we endeavored to go out and look at other industries and professions that had as their core, by necessity, quality, and that is the airline mm-hmm. industry and the medical profession. And so we tried to get learnings or feedback through various consultants in those areas. And it wasn't as fruitful as we thought it would be, at least in my opinion.
I think, yeah, I would agree with that, Cindy. I think it opened people's minds to the fact that there are a lot of other industries out there that have found ways to measure quality in a reasonably successful way, and that there are tools and methodologies that can be used, and the consultants that we used, I thought, brought a very good perspective on that. The challenge which you're alluding to, which I think we struggled with, was then applying that to the complexities of the audit process, given that the external audit itself is just one component of a much bigger platform, if you like, of elements which go into high quality financial reporting. And I think that's where it became a challenge.
And then the only other thing I would add is, with respect to the definition, Stephen is right. We spent several months wrestling through what a definition of audit quality might be, because it seemed like that would be the place to start. And it was actually IFIAR that I had mentioned earlier. Lou and his colleagues asked me to come and present to IFIAR in Washington, D.C., and when I was talking to them about the struggle of defining audit quality, their advice was, well, then don't define it. That's where people get caught up, and by trying to define audit quality, it's easy to tank the entire project. And so I don't think, Lou, you all endeavored to define audit quality either.
No, we didn't, because I think we figured that was a rabbit hole that once we went down, we'd never get out of. And, you know, it used to be what I would always hear. I'm a lawyer by training. I'm not an auditor, but I spent a lot of my career representing auditors. And one of the things I always used to hear, particularly as a lawyer, and I would hear it from auditors, well, I know a quality audit when I see it. You know, and I can tell when, I can look at an audit and see people did a bad job on this, but don't ask me to define it. I couldn't say really what there was about it. So we concluded very early on that was not fruitful, and that we needed to go another way, and that's why we came up with a series of measures that hopefully might be able to be correlatable with data, and also replicatable. That was the other thing.
So just, you mentioned that you were a lawyer. There's a famous Supreme Court lawyer who has a famous quote about another topic. His quote is,
pornography.
I know it when I see it.
Justice, Justice Stewart, I can't define it, but I know it when I see it.
Exactly. So not to equate audit quality indicators to pornography, but. So Stephen, to talk to the group about, first of all, about more about scalability, because that was really important. And I think that's a question that you asked too at the PCAOB. You know, does this apply to everybody? Should it apply to everybody? Mm-hmm. And that was very important, because we have companies and audit committees and firms of all sizes, and that was something that was very important to us.
Yes, we didn't want to fall in the trap where we were trying to come up with a one-size-fits-all solution for all the reasons you just articulated, Cindy. And I'm sure Leslie will touch on this point, that was feedback we certainly got from the audit committees as well, and audit committee members. And if you think about the diversity of public companies and the size and industries that they're in, the diversity of the size and complexity of the various infrastructures that they have supporting their audit process, and the firms themselves, we quickly recognized that there needed to be flexibility built in to whatever solution we proposed, and an element of tailoring and customization that could lead to scalability, but still provide an appropriate level of feedback to the audit committee on the level of audit quality that was being conducted in the external audit.
That's very, very consistent with the feedback we heard at those dinners that Cindy mentioned at the beginning.
So So Stephen, another big project within the initiative on audit quality indicators was we sought out to pilot test the indicators as we had envisioned them. We, at one point, we had talked about our audit quality indicators as an experiment, right, with a hypothesis, and so we wanted to test our hypothesis. And so we actually went out and got some of our members' engagement teams to work with their audit committees to pilot test the indicators. And so we had some interesting results, and if you would, if you could give everybody just kind of an overview of what those findings were.
Yep, I'd be happy to, Cindy. And yes, Cindy told me this was going to be a 6-month assignment, and I'm now well into my third year, so this has certainly turned out to be a large and significant project. We had, I think, Cindy, was it about 30 engagements across a number of different firms and industries that we conducted the pilots on during the fiscal 14 audit cycle. And I'll sort of divide up my feedback from what we learned into what we heard from the audit engagement teams and then what we heard from the audit committees, which I'm sure Leslie will embellish. But the engagement teams, generally speaking, said, you know, it clearly enhanced the conversation with the audit committee. We had a higher level of engagement around the important topics that impacted either the areas of risk that we were focused on or the overall quality of the audit. And that was a distinct positive. And that they were able to identify certain measures which seemed to trigger those more in-depth, rich, robust conversations with the audit committees. One, for example, would be around the industry experience of the engagement team. That seemed to be an indicator for which rich dialogue tended to flow. Most of the data was reasonably available. It didn't take a huge amount or a significant amount of additional work to pull this data together, although I think it would be fair to say the level of efficiency across the firms was mixed, and there was a recognition that having now been through this one cycle, there would be better and easier and more formalized ways that this data could be provided and disseminated. As far as what we heard from the audit committees themselves, again, we heard this sort of overall sense that yes, this was positive, yes, this was useful, but then a very sort of quick caveat that certain of the indicators were more useful than others. And just to sort of paraphrase at a high level, the indicators around experience and workload seem to be seen as more useful. The indicators around, you know, how much training the firms do, how many years of service that engagement team members have seem to be less useful to audit committee members. So the point that you made, Lou, and again, I feel confident Leslie's going to touch upon, there was feedback around the volume. You know, don't overwhelm us. We have a lot on our plate. We have a lot of responsibilities. Our agendas are full. So don't create a monster here in that this becomes such a vast number of indicators or a large amount of information that we can't digest or look at appropriately or get to a reasonable conclusion with. There was sort of this feeling that less is more, I think, is how I would describe it. We did get some audit committees that pushed back a little bit simply on getting things on agendas, because agendas were pretty full, and just timing issues around actually putting time to focus on this. But overall, there was support. And I think what we saw was a lining up behind the idea that this conversation would take place annually, probably around the planning conversation with the audit committee. And then to the extent that these indicators during the course of the year started to demonstrate that there was an issue or a concern, that on an exception basis, then the conversation would come back to the audit committee. The last comment I will make, because I don't want to go too far into some of the topics that I suspect Leslie will cover, but there was a lot of feedback around the need for context and narrative, that the indicators alone in a vacuum without discussion with the engagement team, without understanding the context without having a very sort of qualitative, contextual discussion and narrative around them, they were significantly less meaningful and could actually be misinterpreted. So I think I'll leave it there for a moment.
Okay, good. So I'm going to turn to Leslie here in just a moment. Questions on this segment? Yes. And can you, I hate to make you do this, we're videotaping. Can you go to the microphone here? And those of you that want to ask questions, maybe line up because.
It's a very important conversation, but it looks like it's a little bit limited to the like auditors, audit committee members, and PCAOB, because most of the data that you mentioned, like simple workload, is not available for us as academics. I cannot even like tell to students, for example, what's the typical workload in one firm versus another one. So what's your plans for the future? Do you plan to kind of engage more academics to help you out, or you just kind of want us to keep informed and just deliver some of this?
I mean, I guess let me take a crack at that. I think this is part of one of the reasons we'd like you to comment on it, because frankly, we'd like to hear your views to what extent these indicators and the material that lies behind them should be made public. If they're completely kept private and kept between the accounting firm and the audit committee, you will not know that. If there are certain things that have to be disclosed, there will at least be some data that may be subject to being able to be studied.
Therein, I think, lies the difficulty of this, in that in order to have a rich discussion and context, you have to have the two parties face-to-face, and that's hard to do with public disclosure of indicators. But what we have seen emerging is more and more, at least the largest firms, are starting to voluntarily disclose similar metrics on a firm-wide basis to those that either the PCAOB has in their concept release or that the CAQ has in our approach. So ours are our engagement team. The PCAOB hasn't yet determined that, but what you are seeing firms doing is on a firm-wide basis starting to disclose some of these things like workload, number of hours, and those types of things. So, you know, our view at the CAQ is that this stuff should grow organically, and that since the audit committee is the one directly charged with overseeing the audit process, that and to have that conversation, it should be engagement team to audit committee, and that they not be publicly disclosed. But I think you're going to see more information coming out. I don't know if it's the type of information, frankly, though, that will help academics do a study. And I don't know, Leslie, were you gonna weigh in?
I guess my only thought about that would be that this is not an all or nothing proposition. There could be some things that are disclosed, some things that are only disclosed to the audit committee, some things that are disclosed to the audit committee, the PCAOB, and for example, firm management, et cetera. So I don't know if we have to come to the same conclusion about all of this.
Oh, that's a fair point. Yes.
I guess continuing on this topic, it seems like the firms have a lot of access to the, you know, process and input levels that could explain when we have audit quality problems. So are the firms tracking it themselves to try to learn about what levels of these inputs and process measures explain or predict audit quality outcomes, or, you know, getting help? Because I think we can learn so much from these indicators now that we're collecting, and maybe we can't do it as academics, but if the firms could help us understand, you know, what of these factors are driving audit quality outcomes. So I was just wondering if the firms have been collecting it at an engagement level and what they're doing with that information.
Yes, thank you. Good question. So obviously we're at a very early stage at the moment, because as it relates to these particular indicators, we've just completed a pilot of 30 engagements across, you know, half a dozen firms or so. and we're learning from that process. Somewhat independently, but also in parallel with that process, the firms do spend an awful lot of time looking at the root causes that lie behind where there are audit deficiencies or areas of improvement needed in our audit process. And I think what we're going to find is if we get this right, we'll start to see some correlation between the set of indicators that we're looking at and what we're learning through our root cause analysis, so that we have some alignment and correlation there. But I think, and I'd be interested, there are other practitioners in the audience that may want to contribute to this question, but it's early days yet in that journey. But I think ultimately that would be a place that would be a very positive place to land.
This also ties in with the initiative that the PCAOB's Division of Registration and Registration and Inspections has, which is in root cause analysis. We not only do our own root cause analysis when we find of the particular firms when we find audit deficiencies, but we require the firms to bring to us and present their own root cause analysis as part of their remediation process. And this starts not with identifying the audit quality indicators, but it starts with the deficiencies. And then from the deficiency, you have to sort of induce or deduce, whichever way it works, you have to deduce what the root causes of that failure were. But they could impact any one of these root cause analyses. So these things are working at two different levels. One is sort of starting at the top with the indicators themselves. The other is starting with the failures and trying to find out what were the causes of these failures. But clearly many of them are maybe behavioral, maybe educational, maybe structural within the firms. There are all kinds of things that need to be looked at. But this is something that is one of the most important initiatives of the PCAOB, and it's something that we actually mandate, at least among the larger firms, that if you want to do a remediation with us to keep your part two of your inspection report non-public, you have to bring to us a root cause analysis.
So Lou, just a follow-up question on that. Is that part of the data set that would be available to the researchers who request access to confidential PCAOB data or not?
Yes.
So the fellows, yeah?
Yes, I think it would be. It's part of the data. It depends on what your project was. I mean, we don't make the entire data set available to anybody. I mean, we sort of give you the parts of it that are relevant to what you want to do. But yes, it would be available. Obviously, when it's published, you can't disclose firm names and things. We have to shield that, but the data set should be available.
Yeah, so are all of you familiar with what they're talking about? Those of you that were at the auditing section luncheon, Luigi,
Zingales
from the PCAOB's Office of Research. They have a fellowship program where you can apply to do a project, and you would be a fellow, and you could come in and physically be at the PCAOB, either in the Washington office or elsewhere, and do research using their proprietary data. So it's, I think, the one place where scholars and researchers can get that kind of data that the profession has been unable to provide and you might have been unable to get prior. So there is a process. Not everybody is allowed to just go in. You have to apply. But I think the application process is open right now. Is that
correct?
Yes,
it is. Well, it will be the applications won't be due until February of 2016. But there is a process whereby you can apply to essentially get access to our data, but in order to do it, you essentially have to be a PCAOB fellow. But we're trying to, initially, you had to come and be resident at the PCAOB. We're gradually opening that up so you don't have to be resident. You could get access. You may have to come to the PCAOB to get the data. We don't let you take the data off, but the analysis then can be done other places. We have some fellows who show up at the PCAOB periodically, maybe a couple of days a month, to do work on the data. But yes, that's so. If that's something that's of interest to you, you should look into that. And we also pay.
So one other thing I wanted to, and if you make your way up to the microphone, Tatsumi, I can just make this one point, that I think is important given the conversation that we just had about the root cause analysis, whether it's within the firm or that the PCAOB is mandating, and the Audit Quality Indicators Project. At least the way I look at it, you know, the root cause analysis is looking at how things went wrong, where things went wrong, where things weren't quite what they should have been, or where they were deficient. Where I think the hope is, both from the PCAOB and the CAQ's perspective, is that this would be a way to try to tease out maybe a root cause analysis of how things go right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right, and so, yes, those two things looked at together will give you a whole picture, but I think it's the first time that we've all tried to focus on the positive side.
Right.
Which is important to understand as well, right? When an audit goes right, can we discern out at least what are some of those pieces
right.
that led to that?
Okay, so thank you. So there are two sets of the AQIs at the moment existed, set by the CAQ and also the PCAOB. So if the PCAOB decide AQI will be not mandatory. So in that case, what the relationship between these two sets of the AQI indicators?
Are you assuming that they were not mandatory?
Yeah, if you leave it as non-mandatory, so two sets of the AQI will stays within the US, I think. So in that case, what relationship do you have in mind, AQIs by the CAQ and also the PCAOB's AQI?
Well, first of all, there's a huge amount of overlap
between
the
two
of them. So, but I assume if they're not mandatory, you could choose between them. Now, having said that, one of the things I will say is that we have been told that there are lawyers, particularly securities lawyers, who give advice to audit committees that don't think that anything the PCAOB says is voluntary. That basically, if the PCAOB says this is best practice, or you might think about doing this, you damn well better do it, or somebody, some litigant, will claim that you knew this was out there, this had been suggested, and you didn't do it. I mean, I think that's a gross overreading of what the law should be, but that that is a reality that we at the PCAOB at least have to live with.
So that means
you probably had that at FASB too, Leslie, didn't you? That
absolutely not.
What?
So that
you made a speech, people.
So we tried not to.
In that case, each audit committee can choose the sort of their own combination of the CAQ's AQIs and also PCAOB's AQI. It could happen in the future.
Yeah, I think it's probably happening as we speak. I believe that there are a number of audit committees who are voluntarily following the CAQ approach or some version of that, tailoring it, which is a huge piece of feedback we heard from the audit committee community. We want to be able to tailor these to the needs of our company at this particular time. And one of the reasons they want them to be voluntary is because they want to be able to use their judgment as to what information they want from their auditors. So now that I think the PCAOBs are out there, I think that gives audit committees further food for thought. Are there any of them on there or some variation? Could you mush one of the CAQs with one of the PCAOBs and tailor it? So if these remain voluntary, I think these are just to give audit committees ideas of the types of questions that they could ask their engagement teams that might help them get to this, what's the secret sauce for a good audit?
No, I would agree with that. I think you made all the points I was going to make in response. I was going to highlight the fact that during the development process from the CAQ perspective and from the PCOB's perspective, there was a lot of dialogue between the teams. There was an open dialogue about some of the challenges and opportunities and things that each team were focused on. So it's probably not surprising that there are, that combined with the very nature of the topic that we're dealing with, that there's some overlap. And I think there's a common interest and desire to position audit committees in the best place possible to have the right set of indicators for their circumstances and their situation. And I could envisage an opportunity where that might be a mix of what's out there at the moment, if it were on a voluntary basis.
Yeah, so Leslie, I want to turn to you now and have you give us audit committee perspectives, both wearing your audit committee member hat as well as being the moderator of not only two of our discussions, but then also Stephen mentioned our stakeholder advisory panel before we went out and put our approach forward in public. You helped us with that as well. So you've had a number of opportunities to liaise with the audit committee community and get their perspectives.
Yep. Well, first I want to thank you for including me on this panel because I am fairly new to the audit committee community. And yet I have spent my entire career around auditors and accountants. But having said that, I think I'd like to spend a minute just going back to basics about why we have an audit. And of course, it's to provide some assurance that the financial statements of a company are fairly stated. But having said that, there are clearly other participants in the process of preparing financial statements, and that's not the only source of financial information that the investing public is using. The key point I want to make there is that the audit committee is responsible for all of that. And so, for the oversight of all of that, I should say. And so, you know, when we approach this issue, and we're here today to talk about the public accountants and their role in the financial reporting process, I think it's important to keep that in mind because when we're looking at the quality of the audit as part of that process, to me, as an audit committee member, the most important element of quality is the people who are carrying out the audit. We can talk about metrics and we can talk about other inputs to the process, but at the end of the day, the primary way that audit committees interface with the external audit team is through direct observation and conversation. And so there really is no substitute for that qualitative assessment of the people who are carrying out your audit and whether they have the right skills and attributes. So when I think about what those essential attributes are, it starts with, and this point has already been made, but the industry expertise of the team, as well as other elements of expertise. How technologically savvy are they? Do they have experience in global locations, and do they have the support of the firm for all of the above? Very importantly, do they show insight and good analytical abilities, and do I think that they have identified the key risks that are associated with this business and this audit at this point in time? Without those analytical skills and evidence that they're able to modify the audit plan in response to the changing economic environment or the changing activities of the company, you could have the smartest people with the best scores, who have all the right credentials, but if they're not responsive and they're not analytical, the audit is doomed to fail, in my opinion. We also, of course, want to know how the individuals and how the firm is approaching independence and objectivity. And this is where I do think that attestation and other forms of representations from the firm is extremely important. You can't always get that from a conversation, but we actually need some data about that to satisfy ourselves that the firm is independent and especially the team itself. And last but not least, I think that we're expecting the individuals on the engagement to proactively raise issues with the audit committee and have the wherewithal and backbone to stand up to management and the audit committee when there's a problem. It's just as important to have those communication skills as it is to have any of the other metrics that, that we'll be talking about for the rest of this, this panel. So I mentioned that the primary way we do this assessment today is through direct observation and interaction. But I will tell you that we are already getting a lot of information by requesting it from the firms. Some of it comes on an engagement basis, and some of it comes on a firm-wide basis. But I don't want to leave you with the impression that this is new to audit committees and that we haven't been thinking about these issues. It's just, to me, it's an enhancement, potentially. And I'd like to just make sure that we all keep it in that context. I will say that I'm not sure that most audit committee members are in a position to assess whether the team is bringing the right audit plan, to assess, you know, some of these very in the weeds kinds of issues for audits that most of us can appreciate, but they clearly want to know that the firm is committed to excellence in these areas and is doing a good job managing it. So just to emphasize that the audit committee is in an oversight role, not a management role, even with regard to the audit. And so there's a line there. Of how much a typical audit committee member can digest, understand, and add value. So that's where I think we just want to keep in mind the competencies of a typical audit committee member, which, by the way, could relate to the definition of a financial expert, which is one of the things the SEC is asking about right now.
So I want to pick up on something, Leslie, that you mentioned, because I think this is a struggle for audit quality indicators in general. You mentioned one of the key things for an audit committee member is the analytical capabilities of their engagement team. So things like insight, judgment, skepticism, objectivity, all of these things are very qualitative in nature. They don't lend themselves to an indicator, to a metric, to a number. And that's one of the things that we heard in our pilot tests, that these are great, CAQ, this stuff that you're telling us, that you're having our engagement team tell us, but give us the other stuff too, right? Give us that qualitative stuff. And there aren't a lot of qualitative indicators in the PCAOB suite either. So is there some way to crack that nut? I mean, I'll tell you honestly, we at the CAQ really struggled. We have tone at the top as one of our indicators, but we don't really have an idea as to how to get that, get your hands around that. So I want to hear from all three of you on the qualitative.
You know, we're in a room full of mostly professors, and so I just want to use an analogy. You know, when I used to hire recent graduates at the FASB, we would hire many, many people a year. We had a minimum GPA cutoff, right? And it really was 4.0, because we could attract the 4.0 students. But the fact of the matter is that there's still a range of 4.0 students, right? You could have very, very smart students who just don't have those qualitative aspects that I'm trying to describe. And likewise, you could have a student with a 3.3 who does. And so, you know, that's why I want to be really careful that this doesn't become about managing those metrics. Because at the end of the day, I still am going to put primacy on those qualitative factors. So to answer your question, I think that a couple of things have already been done that are really helpful in this regard. I think that the PCAOB issuing the audit committee dialogue is really helpful to say to audit committees, hey, these are the kinds of issues we're seeing. We think you should be asking about them when you talk to your auditors. I think that was really helpful. And likewise, the CAQ has issued the external auditor review tool. Probably got that name wrong.
The assessment tool.
The assessment tool.
But thank you.
And that kind of thing, which is entirely best practice oriented, you know, it's voluntary in a sense, but I don't know an audit committee member who's not going to read it, right, and benefit from it so that it will enhance the dialogue. And, of course, the firms are reading these things, too. So I have to tell you that the next deck after these things were issued that I got from our auditors on both engagements included these things. So it's happening. And That's not to say that we can't still make some enhancement. It's not to say that some things shouldn't be mandatory. But everything I have just said has been in the context of a dialogue between the audit committee and the auditors.
Cindy, I think this challenge of quantitative and qualitative really led us to the conclusion that we wanted to engage with audit committees around audit quality indicators. Because of all the reasons that Leslie just articulated, the audit committee is in the best position to make a qualitative assessment over the people that are conducting the audit, and combined with some quantitative data that was relevant and meaningful and tailored for that particular engagement, could support and enhance their ability to make those qualitative assessments. And that's why we landed as the audit committee as the primary focus for this dialogue.
And one of the things we've done in putting our thing out is to caution. We're very aware of the fact that Leslie makes an excellent point that don't be misled that these quantitative numbers are somehow talismanic. And we're very aware of the phrase that what gets measured gets managed. And so we do not want to drive audit performance and audit selection on the basis of a bunch of numbers, that you can't get rid of the human aspect of this, and the aspect of judgment and getting together with people and watching them in experience and seeing how they actually do in the field, that those are ultimately the most important things that will determine whether you like your auditor and whether you're comfortable with your auditor. It's not going to be a bunch of measures, but that's why I would go back and stress again that the measures are to enable you, or to enable an audit committee or anybody who uses them, to ask questions, potentially to make some comparative questions. Well, why is our audit different from that audit? And explain to me, why our numbers on this particular thing are different from other audits in your firm in this industry. Explain to me why that was different. I mean, you may be able to do it, but that's not something we can get to with objective data. What we knew, though, is that without some kind of measures, we didn't really have anything very meaningful to say. We could say that, based on our inspection results, the industry has these problems, and we put out reports saying that. These are the areas where there are failures. That's not all that useful, or deficiencies. Right. But we use failure to mean a very particular kind of thing that doesn't mean failure in the sense that other users of the English language mean it.
I know. I just had to say that. So one thing I want to kind of pivot to, go ahead.
You mentioned earlier that one of your concerns is not to create any unintended effects, potential negative effects from these quality, formalizing the quality indicators. I'd love to hear the thoughts of the panel. If there is a concern that formalizing these quality indicators would expose auditors to more litigation, where plaintiff's attorneys could potentially justify or build a case on auditors not meeting one of those criteria that you have formalized, and maybe that's not the most important criteria in engagement, but attorneys are very smart people, and I just wanted to see what you think about that.
Well, I'll start, and then I would like to hear from all of you. I do think that's kind of what Lou is getting at when he says managing to the metrics, right? So if you use years in the industry as an important metric that a audit committee might want. And another thing too, I think both the PCAOB and the CAQ have been very clear to say that no one indicator can tell you quality, right? You have to look at them holistically and in a package, but even that can't tell you. But let's say everybody agreed that years in industry was an important piece of information. And you're right, then the question is, well, what's the right number? Should it be 25 years? Should it be 10 years? Should it be 15 years? And that's why we have kind of landed on an engagement level to audit committee approach, so that the audit committee can make their own determination maybe if it's 25, that might be too high, right? Because the person's stale and our company is branching out and going into new lines of business. So we want somebody who has more technology, even though it's a financial institution. But I think that's kind of what you're getting at, Lou, with the managing to the metric, which is if we all decide 25 is the right number, then that's what you're going to get, and it might not be the best for the company.
I mean, partly, but to answer quite specifically your question there, which is it possible that, let's assume, I don't know, number of audit experience or industry experience, you know, was a metric that was put out there and somebody didn't meet that there will be a claim based on that. That is possible. But I think it's unlikely that could succeed because in addition to making the claim, you have to establish causation. And there's nothing, I think there's nothing in these indicators that necessarily indicates that they're causative. And so I don't see that. I'm talking legally now, but I don't see that as a real legal risk. It's a lawyer's, you know, we used to talk about when I did criminal law that, you know, a grand jury could indict a ham sandwich. You can bring any kind of case, but you have to be able to establish causation. And the mere fact that you didn't meet a metric does not establish causation.
Implied in the fact that those are audit quality indicators?
Not necessarily. I don't think it necessarily is implied in that. It may be correlative, but it's not necessarily causative.
If I could just add to that, you know, it really does depend on the type of indicator you're talking about. If it's something about, for example, an indicator of internal control weaknesses, do we want the number to be high or do we want the number to be low, right? Are they finding the weaknesses or are they not? I think, you know, that risk can be managed in many ways. For example, turning down clients that seem like they're a little shady, so you're gonna have a low number. Whereas if you're a firm that takes on a client and you find some problems, you wanna just make sure that they're being addressed in an appropriate way. But I don't know what to do with that indicator. You need to know so much more before you can make a judgment about whether there's a quality issue with the audit or the firm.
Which is exactly why we kept hearing you've got to have the context, the narrative, the qualitative discussion around the metric. And I think that therein lies a little bit of a dilemma for the profession in that our instinct is to want to be more transparent and to disclose more in terms of the quality indicators that we're discussing today and the positive progress that's being made in improving audit quality. But we recognize without the context that Leslie just described, you not only is it open to misinterpretation, but you could actually get 180 degrees wrong in terms of what the underlying issue was there within the quality of that particular audit.
I don't mean to be unkind, really, but what I'm hearing is a proposal or two proposals for the imposition of a new compliance burden on accounting firms and audit committees to report and consider information for which no correlation or causation has yet been established with respect to audit quality, a concept that you've decided not to define. Is that a mischaracterization of the proposal?
It's an exaggeration of it, I think. I don't know if it's a mischaracterization, but I wouldn't want to adopt it, frankly. Part of the reason that the correlations haven't been established yet is because nobody's looked at this stuff before. We don't know. We may be able to establish them, but you've got to have the data first. We don't have it today.
Shouldn't you have the causation before you impose the burden?
We're not. First of all, nobody's talking about imposing a burden here. No, but I think one of the things we're looking at, if we made this mandatory in a certain, maybe that would impose a burden. But I think that's an open question. We don't know whether they should be mandatory or not. That's a question that's being asked. If they're not mandatory, the mere fact that the data is available and that the thing can be asked by somebody, if they find it useful, they don't have to ask it if they don't want to. Over time, bodies of data would be developed that presumably might establish correlations, and then once you look at the correlations, maybe that leads to causation. I don't know. I don't think any of us knows at this point, but I mean, I think you've sort of jumped to the most positive or most negative end possibility of this that I don't think, frankly, is really realistic. That's not to rain on your parade.
I would just add, from the CAQ's perspective in terms of what we've been focused on, one thing that clearly came out of the pilots was an enhanced conversation with the audit committee about the areas of the audit that were most important, where there was greatest risk, and what the audit team was doing to address that risk, whether they had the skills and capabilities, industry experience, the specialists on the team to resolve it. And that was an enhancement in the robustness of the dialogue between the audit committee and the engagement team, and that's got to be a good thing in terms of audit quality. And so for me, that in of itself is worthy of the effort to put this on the table in a fashion where it can be done in a tailored and customized form on an engagement basis with the audit committee, so that it is most meaningful for that particular entity.
But the only way I can really envision evaluating whether I think the audit team identified the right risks is to say, on a scale of 1 to 10, how good were they at identifying the right risk? I just don't know how you take, you know, if you can picture your typical heat map of the risks of an organization, which, you know, depending on the complexity of the organization and other factors, could have 20 risks on it. You know, we want to make sure they've A, identified the ones that are the most important, B, put them in the right quadrants, and C, are explaining, you know, how they're tailoring the audit to address that analysis. What's the metric? You know, like I said, it's how good a job did they do? Scale of 1 to 10, that's kind of the only way I can think of turning it into a metric. And by the way, I mean, at the FASB, we used to deal with this kind of thing all the time. How do you assess the quality of an accounting standard? And struggled with very similar issues about how to turn it into a metric. And so we would periodically do a survey of stakeholders and say, how do you think we're doing on the following factors? Independence, this, that, you know. And it's still very subjective, but you can compare it from year to year. You know, see, are we trending up, are we trending down, is there a new area of concern, et cetera.
Well, and to that very point, we were very careful, as I think the PCAOB was too, not to call them metrics,
right,
but to call them indicators.
Yeah.
So they're directional, right? They're meant to get you focused on the right things. But this is certainly something I think we heard in our pilot test too, is I don't think there were any of the indicators that we had in the CAQ that an audit committee weren't at least using some of.
Yeah.
And some of the pilot test findings were, ho-hum, we already do this. We you know, thanks, but no thanks. Mm-hmm. Or thanks, but thanks, right? We're already doing this, so it's nothing new. Others came back and said, oh, okay, well, so we asked some of these questions, but not all of these, so that's helpful too. Mm-hmm. We've got to start, right? I mean, what's been the impediment for years? And you mentioned, Lou, the ACAP. Actually, this goes beyond that, right? The FRC in the UK looked at this. The IAASB has looked at it twice. I mean, this has been something that I think the profession has been trying to do for decades. And so we just thought, you know what? We got to dive in and start. And on this one, you know, maybe perfection's the enemy of the good. So we have a question here and then here. Go ahead, you can get up. He was waiting, I'm sorry. No, you go.
I have two questions. One concerns the fact the regulations, because current, the SOX Act does not provide power to audit committee in terms, if there are conflicts of interest with management in the area of accounts or quality. Now, do you need a regulation in order to adopt this perspective? And my second question concerns the foreign companies. There are a large number of foreign companies listed on a stock exchange in the US. I take example of the European companies. They don't have the same requirements. European Commission, for example, does not have any requirements for audit committee that leaves to the national regulators in terms of expertise, in terms of independence, for example, that they, these areas are actually treated with the codes, national codes, and the codes say that you may have majority of members independent and et cetera. Therefore, how do you deal with the question of the foreign companies that listed on a stock exchange in the United States? And the first one concerns the, in fact, maybe conflicts with management in the number of areas. Thank you.
Well, with respect to the first one, and you all can correct me if I'm wrong, but there are actually very specific rules meant to get at the conflict of interest that the auditor could have with management. And
vice versa.
Right. And so that's very well regulated. I think the PCAOB inspects on that. The SEC certainly has authority there too. Now I know there's the question that the European Commission got to about mandatory firm rotation, trying to get at are there underlying conflicts that while you technically may be meeting the rules and regulations, but I think here in the United States, we've moved away from that because we think that we have a robust system that gets to these conflicts of interest. But I don't know if anybody wants to weigh in on that.
No, that's right.
Yeah. And then Lou, I don't know if you want to take the what other jurisdictions are doing question or foreign companies registered on the New York Stock Exchange or elsewhere.
You know, first of all, the only jurisdiction that at least the PCAOB has is over public companies that are registered, or foreign companies that are registered in the United States. If they're not registered in the United States, we have no jurisdiction over them. There are a lot of foreign companies that have operations here, but do not have registered securities here, and neither we nor the SEC has jurisdiction over those companies. With respect to audit committees abroad, you're right that the European Commission so far has not asserted jurisdiction over audit committees. That's left to national regulation, but there is very robust national regulation, for example, in the United Kingdom, in Germany, in France, of audit committees and of what they do. I mean, we look in many ways, or at least I personally look oftentimes to what the United Kingdom and particularly the Financial Reporting Council is doing with respect to audit committees, because I think it's very, very forward-looking, very, really quite imaginative. In terms of audit quality indicators, there are also international projects on this right now. The government of Singapore, ACRA, the audit and securities regulator in Singapore, has just come out with a group of eight audit quality indicators that are not mandatory but are voluntary, but they are suggesting that these are inquiries that the audit committees of Singapore-based public companies should ask. And the Swiss regulator, if you look at its Swiss audit regulator, if you look at its 2014 report of activities, reports on 14 audit reports on a group of audit quality indicators, not broken down by firm, but simply broken down by the inspections that it did, and it reports ranges. For example, ratios of partner to staff activity. It will report a ratio from the minimum to the maximum that they found, and it gives 5 years of data on that. So it's there are other jurisdictions that are doing this. I mean, I think it's I can tell you that IFIAR, the International Forum of Independent Audit Regulators that I've been actively involved in, has a project that's looking at this right now. So
yeah, so I think we'll see more countries looking at audit quality indicators.
Yeah. I mean, it's something that's sort of on the current agenda.
Been very patient.
That's great. I'm curious, with the firms now investing extensively in data analytics, changing the effectiveness of the audit, auditing populations versus samples, to what extent are the indicators able to capture the firm's use of those sophisticated sort of analytic technologies compared to another firm that may not have that capability? Would those be captured? I can see it in the audit results side, but is there other parts of the indicators that might capture that?
Yeah, it's a very good question, and it sort of is encapsulated in this whole notion of the scalability issue, whether it's not just the size and sophistication of the registrants, but the size and sophistication of the firms who are operating at different places across the market. I would say at this point that the recommended set of indicators that we've put out from the CAQ has not probably given sufficient input from that issue. I think the firms are moving so fast in terms of their adoption of this technology. We're all experimenting with it in different ways. We're all looking to include it into our audit approaches in a different fashion. Frankly, I don't think it really filtered through into our dialogue around this set of audit indicators probably as sufficiently as it will need to in the next round. And I think the challenge will be the issue that you point out, which is scalability. And so I think it gets back to this issue of flexibility and the ability for this set of indicators to not only recognize that different audit committees and registrants may need to put a combination and permutation of these indicators together that best suits them, but that the firm that's working with them may have more relevance to certain indicators than others as well. But in all honesty, I don't think we're as sophisticated there yet as we're going to have to be as we move forward. I don't know what you think, Cindy.
No, we did. I agree. We didn't really consider that at all. But I'm curious, do you see that, Leslie? I mean, do you see their use of data and technology as an audit committee member?
Well, I wanted to share that this is one of the topics that came up at the dinners as an area where an indicator would be helpful. That we're not currently getting. So something to indicate investment in technology, talent, and innovation. And we weren't very clear on what that meant, but just something to show, is this firm investing for the future, and is it trying to address some of these changes in technology?
Yeah, I think that could get to tone at the top, right? And
yeah.
So maybe that's a deeper dive. I said we didn't have much on tone at the top other than it was important. Maybe that is a question that the audit committee could ask of the engagement team to get at that notion of tone at the top.
But investment in technology is our indicator number 17.
Uh-huh.
So.
I think
so
that one would be welcomed.
You know, one of the ways we get at tone at the top is interesting, is the question of, I mean, we have a couple of indicators for that, but one of them is basically a question of compensation. How is senior leadership compensated? And how is the senior audit leadership compensated? Is it compensated on audit quality measures, or is it on other things like business getting?
Yeah, that's, I think, gonna be very interesting to see what comments you get back on that. I'll be honest, at the CAQ, and Stephen weigh in, when we tried to tease that out, we didn't get a lot back. I think, first of all, frankly, speaking about that in a group setting, I think is uncomfortable for our members. They don't really want to talk with their peers and their competitors how they compensate their individuals, which I understand, but certainly it's a question I think audit committee members could ask. And I think that a lot of firms might have, I'm going to way overgeneralize this, but have the mindset that you're paid for doing a quality audit. And so the incentives are more negative than they are positive, right? That there might be a penalty if there's a problem following the firm's protocols, or if something is flagged during an internal review, say, but that they don't articulate a reward for doing a quality audit because that's the expectation. And I know that sounds oversimplified and flip, but and yet it's true, right? It's kind of the Ford quality is job one, right? If that's the expectation, and that you're gonna do your best. So we're not going to give you extra rewards for doing your best. Is that summarize it?
No, I think that's well stated. And we did go down this path, as you alluded to, Cindy. And I think it was given an appropriate level of debate and discussion. It wasn't something that the firms just immediately said, well, we don't want to go there. But the number of challenges that came up, not just related to sort of confidentiality between the firms, but just the complexities involved in the different compensation systems, And I think the feeling that this is an element, is certainly an element of tone if it is not being appropriately applied, but it is only one element and it has to be balanced with the other components of tone within an organization. And you run the risk of running to something that potentially is can be measured and then overemphasizing it at the risk of other components which are more qualitative that can't easily be measured, which gets us back to our quantitative versus qualitative debate.
Other questions from the audience? So I'm going to now switch a little bit and talk about reporting. So the SEC has a concept release out right now on audit committee disclosures, and it too is a concept release, and I think Lou has stressed this about the PCAOB's work. This is a concept release, this is not a proposed standard, and same thing on the SEC. But so my question is, since we're talking about, at least from the CAQ's perspective, that these should be voluntary and they should be engagement team to the audit committee, is it an expectation, or should we expect, or would it be helpful for audit committees to report in the proxy or the audit committee report, hey, we're looking at AQIs of our auditors. We're looking at the quality and we're using some set of indicators to look at this. Now, our view at the CAQ is that you need to tread carefully on audit committee disclosure. We'd like to see more of it. We've encouraged more of it, but we also appreciate that there can be a chilling factor if you get down into some of the specific things that the SEC, for instance, was asking. Like, Leslie, tell us about the quality of the conversations that you had with your auditors and what were the top five issues that you talked about. That could be, I think, chilling. Yeah. But can you see, envision a time when you would have in your audit committee report, oh yeah, we look at audit quality indicators as we assess the skills of our auditors?
Yeah, so I think, again, there are different ways to do this. One way would be for us to have a robust dialogue about what are the key factors of audit quality and come to some consensus, and then have some guidance for audit committees to say, we would expect you to be touching on the following 10 attributes, whatever it turns out to be, in your evaluation of your existing auditors and in your selection of the new auditors, and we want you to talk about that in your audit committee report. Now, when I say talk about that, I don't think that means we have to give the details of the assessment. I think we could say, require the audit committee to make an affirmative statement. We understand our responsibilities. We are evaluating the auditors using the following, you know, some standard of quality. And they have met those requirements. In our assessment, they have met those requirements. That doesn't mean we need to go into the gory details. And so, I think there's a lot of room between nothing and everything. And I'd like to strike a happy medium so that the public does have some assurance that the audit committee understands its responsibilities and is owning it and taking responsibility for it without some of what I would see as the chilling effect of publicly disclosing a performance evaluation. Maybe it's just scar tissue from my experience at the FASB, where I would get a public performance appraisal on a daily basis. but honestly, I think what we want to do is just make sure those discussions are occurring in a robust way and not necessarily have to take the next step of revealing the details of it.
And I've heard people like Michelle Edkins at BlackRock publicly state that what she's interested in as an investor is that the audit committee has a process and not the details. So yeah, she wants to know that sausage is being made, but she doesn't necessarily need to know how the sausage is being made, if that makes sense.
Yep.
So Lou, do you have a sense? I mean, have you talked to the SEC about that? I know the SEC in their concept release on audit committee reporting actually flags your efforts on the concept release. Any thoughts on what they're expecting?
I don't have a sense of what they're expecting. You know, as I listen to this, though, I'm reminded of the kind of experience of the United Kingdom again on this, where there's a much more, they have now a very detailed audit committee report that's required, public report that's required. But one of the fascinating things that happened there was, this has been superseded by the European Union's rule on audit committee rotation, but the before that became effective, the UK had put in a rule saying that you had to tender for an audit after 10 years, and if you didn't put your audit out for tender, or if you did put it out for tender, but you elected to stay with your own auditor, you had to, the former auditor, you had to explain why. And you explain why in great detail, go in great detail what your analysis was of why you wanted to keep your individual auditor. And one of the things, the UK regulators expected that everybody would keep their auditor and explain. Well, in fact, almost nobody did. Particularly none of the big public companies wanted to go through that explanation process. So they were all tendering and all changing their auditors, which I thought was just fascinating. But in the UK today, in your audit committee report, you've got to disclose the major areas of discussion you had with the auditors about what the areas of highest audit risk were, and a bunch of other stuff. It's instructive to look at the report of a UK public, big public company audit committee, because they're really quite detailed. The Germans have to do the same thing, but those reports are not public. There's what's called a long form audit committee report that the audit committees have to file with the regulators and with the government, but those are not made public. But the UK ones are made public. The other thing that the UK requires that's very interesting is that the Financial Reporting Council in the UK, when it inspects an audit, gives a grade. It's either an A, a B, or a C. And the audit committee, if their audit has been disclosed, has to disclose that grade in their report. They not only do this elaborate discussion, but they have to say, our audit was graded by the Financial Reporting Council as an A, a B, or a C. So it's a very different model, but it's instructive and it's worth, I think, looking at.
Well, we're almost to the end of our time, according to, I can see Lou's iPhone watch and mine as well. My Fitbit tells me the time, and I think we're right at 3:30. So please join me in thanking Leslie, Stephen, and Lou. And then one last entreaty. Please take a look at the PCAOB's concept release and consider responding. You don't need to answer every question they ask. You don't need to answer any of the questions you ask. I believe you can give your high-level thematic responses.
Whatever
they just want to hear from you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.